The story of Midas and the Golden Touch is one of the most famous in Greek mythology.
Today, Brian Rose leads investigations at Gordion. He's been working here for 15 years, uncovering why the city rises to prominence.
When visitors came to Gordion, they would have passed through a giant citadel gate, one of the largest citadel gates anywhere in the Near East.
The huge gateway is over 9 meters high, and the walls more than 6 meters thick. Inside, there's an area for workers, and another for the palaces and public buildings of the elite. Gordion is the capital city of the ancient kingdom of Phrygia, which covers much of modern-day Turkey. It's an hour's drive from the Turkish capital, Ankara.
So why did Gordion become so important? One of the reasons is that it's right in the middle of the Eastern world and the Western world. All the trade routes between East and West pass through Gordion.
Unlike the Greeks and Egyptians, the people of Gordion leave very few written records. Their lives are still shrouded in mystery. Yet one story is passed down for generations. When Midas does a favor for the Greek god Dionysus, he is granted a wish. Midas asks for a magic power to turn everything he touches to gold, making him rich beyond measure. But when he tries to eat, his food turns to gold. When he hugs his daughter, she turns into a golden statue. Dionysus has mercy and tells Midas to wash in the river, which runs gold as the wish drains away.
I do believe that most myths, probably all myths, have got some kind of basis in truth.
Julian Bennett searches for evidence in the hills outside Gordion. First, he needs to find out if Midas is a real person. An astonishing monument cut into the cliff face may offer clues. It's over 18 meters tall and covered with an intricate geometric design of squares and crosses.
They represent buildings or temples, wooden buildings or wooden temples.
Julian thinks the monument could prove that Midas is real.
From the style of this monument, we can date it to about the 8th century BC. Gordion reached its peak around about the 8th century BC, and which we are told was ruled by Midas, so the dates match.
An inscription at the top of the monument provides a further clue. It's written in Phrygian, the ancient language of the area. Phrygian is not fully known, but its similarity to languages like ancient Greek means it can be understood.
What we have is a declaration of a ruler called Midas, who's obviously in command of this area called Phrygia.
This giant monument proves that Midas is not a mythological figure. He's real flesh and blood. Nearby, there's another huge structure. Julian thinks it may reveal more evidence about the society Midas rules over. An ancient staircase has been hewn out of the rock and leads deep underground.
These steps, if carved by hand, must have taken an enormous amount of effort. Chisels, simple tools like that.
As he descends the stairs, Julian finds an ancient rock relief.
What we see here is the head of the man, a shepherd who's leading a very large sheep or a lamb. The head of the animal is not totally clear, but you can see the four legs going down.
It seems an odd thing to carve, but it represents a clue to what lies below. At the foot of the staircase, there's a remarkable system of underground tunnels. So far, archaeologists have only excavated a small section of them.
These tunnels led down to pools that would have been permanently provided with water from a spring source from outside, so that people and animals could come down here to get fresh water on a regular basis. They've got the capability to organise their labour to make a tunnel system like this. They know what they're doing. They are not country bumpkins.
It's proof of the sophistication of Phrygian society. But more evidence is needed to establish the facts behind the story of Midas.
The facade of the Midas monument is covered by geometric decoration. We think that it's a reproduction of what the monumental buildings on the citadel of Gordion would have looked like during the reign of Midas.
The fortified citadel covers an area the size of 20 football fields. Behind its huge gates are the city's most dazzling buildings. They stand over 15 meters high. Striking patterns cover the roofs of the buildings. And stunning geometric designs decorate their fronts. It's a lavish display of status. A way for Midas to show off his wealth for all to see. Inside these buildings, archaeologists make another stunning discovery.
This is the earliest colored stone mosaic that has ever been discovered. It's indicative of the kind of elaborate mosaic floors that would have decorated the buildings of the citadel during the period of Midas. As you look at the mosaic panels, it looks as if you have a series of carpets laid on the floor, each turned in a slightly different direction. And these designs were probably influenced by the textile industry of Gordion.
One source of Gordion's wealth is the industrial scale of its textile production.
Phrygia was most famous for its textile industry. There's a building on the citadel that we've excavated called the Terrace Building, and it was filled with textile workers. In some of the rooms of that building, we found between 500 and 600 loom weights. So this was textile production on a massive scale.
Brian finds further proof of the extraordinary skill of Gordion's craftsmen in the hundreds of astonishing artifacts archaeologists discover at the site.
Over the course of the 8th century BC, the kind of materials or goods that were produced in Phrygia were in great demand throughout the known world. People wanted Phrygian bronze bowls, people wanted Phrygian furniture, and people wanted Phrygian mosaic technology.
Under the rule of Midas, the kingdom of Phrygia is successful, innovative, powerful. Phrygia features in the greatest epic of the era. The kingdom is an ally of Troy in the Trojan War.
During the reign of Midas, Gordion would have been a truly dazzling city, built to impress any diplomat or tourist who came here.
Can Gordion's extraordinary wealth be the origin of the story of the Golden Touch? Gareth Derbyshire has been working at Gordion for 20 years, searching for the evidence behind the myth of the man with the golden touch. He investigates just outside the city walls. Here, dozens of strange mounds of earth seem to stand guard.
Surrounding the city, on the high ground and along ancient routeways, are over 120 of these mounds. They're obviously man-made because of their shape.
They are burial mounds, the tombs of the elite of Gordion society.
These mounds range in date from about the mid 9th century BC to the late 4th century BC. In other words, about 150 years before Midas and 400 years after him.